America roared into the 1970s with the promise of technological progress and social change, but it would prove to be a bumpy flight for the American automobile industry. And for Chrysler, the 70s would begin with high expectations, but end in near disaster.
Big, luxurious, beautiful.
Unfortunately, we had the experience in the 1970s of picking exactly the wrong year, in retrospect, to introduce our new large cars. We had a new line of very attractive large cars in 1974 that debuted the same year as the oil embargo, and then we had another line of new cars in 1979 that debuted during another gas crunch.
The Middle East oil embargo instantly changed the dynamics of the American car market. Long fuel lines and higher gas prices pushed consumers to smaller, more fuel-efficient cars. But few expected that Japanese manufacturers, long derided for poor manufacturing quality, would soon become a major force in the American automobile market.
But what happened in the late 60s is that the quality of all the Japanese models improved greatly, and they began putting larger engines in them and really begin to design the cars with the American market in mind.
As the federal government began demanding greater fuel economy and lower emissions in Detroit's new products, Chrysler struggled for a new identity in an ever-changing market. Unlike General Motors and Ford, Chrysler didn't have the cash reserves to pay for massive shifts in production strategies. With increased government regulation and foreign competition, the smallest of the big three automakers couldn't keep up with the pace of change.
We could feel it when it was happening back then, and there wasn't anybody that did anything wrong politically, there wasn't anybody that did anything wrong in the best interest of the country, but you almost took away something that was the livelihood of thousands and thousands of people in this country. What a shame that would have been.
As the corporation continued to fall behind, the possibility of bankruptcy became more and more real. The problems at Chrysler became symbolic of perceived American failure throughout the nation, and the entire nation was talking about Chrysler Corporation.
Good evening. The Carter administration has agreed to help the Chrysler Corporation.
The country cannot afford to let the Chrysler Corporation go under.
It is imperative that the Congress bail out Chrysler with federal loan guarantees. Both houses are debating that issue.
And I don't think I met a single person who, one, didn't know that Chrysler was in trouble and have an opinion about whether or not we should be saved or whether or not we made good product. We were clearly the topic of every cocktail party and every school debate and on every college campus.
Chrysler looked for new leadership and turned to Lee Iacocca, a former president of Ford, to polish the company's tarnished image.
He was not a car guy. He was not an engineer. He's not a finance man particularly. He's just a very effective, convincing salesman.
And Iacocca had a lot of convincing to do. By late 1979, his primary objective was to persuade the federal government to guarantee a loan agreement worth more than $1.5 billion. Chrysler needed the cash to modernize plants, to create new products, and to save 600,000 jobs throughout the company, its dealerships, and its suppliers.
We do not want anything for free. We're asking for the guarantee of a loan, every last dollar of which will be repaid.
It was, to say the least, a very hard sell.
The Chrysler bailout is a ripoff of the American worker.
It was a complex undertaking, and it was painful. There were plant closings, layoffs, and, ultimately, a $3 billion concession package from union workers and suppliers. Many made enormous sacrifices to keep Chrysler alive.
There were a lot of people who really wanted to make this place work. And I never saw a company like Chrysler where there were so many people whose father had worked here or whose brother worked here. There were a lot of family ties to the corporation, and it meant more to them than just a job.
The Carter administration asked Congress today to bail out the ailing Chrysler Corporation.
By 1980, the government had agreed to the loan guarantee. Now the burden fell on Chrysler to prove it could not only survive, but prosper again, too. Few people could predict that Chrysler's turnaround in the 80s and 90s would be so strong and so dramatic. The story of the new Chrysler Corporation, coming soon on CEN.